First things first, let me tell you why that's funny is a joke title, okay? I know comedy is subjective. I'm not saying I know more than anyone else. I don't want to explain away the joy in humour. I'm just saying that I find the idea of someone doing those things funny. Now, a lot of people are of the opinion that comedy can't be explained, and I'm sure there would be even more people that would say, why try to explain it? Well, the short answer, I guess, would be, I don't know. I feel compelled to, for some psychological and sociological reasons that aren't important. The slightly longer reason would be that I'm working on a master's in comedy, and as such, I have to approach comedy now with the scientific method. Now, let's start talking about a theory behind comedy with this equation you're going to hear the most. Comedy is tragedy plus time. A real-life way to sum this up would be the Hindenburg disaster. Now, the Hindenburg disaster was the greatest catastrophe ever caught on film at the time, but how is it remembered now? What was once an unthinkable horror is now a comic catchphrase that's outlived the knowledge of the actual horror itself. A more modern example of this would be the South Park episode Jerrad Has AIDS from season 6, in which Stan and Kyle tell Cartman that not enough time has passed for them to be able to laugh at the death of their friend Kenny.
Damn it, Butters, keep eating or else I'll kick your ass till you're deader than Kenny!
Dude, that isn't cool. You shouldn't joke about Kenny being dead. Enough time hasn't passed.
So how long until we can joke about it?
22.3 years. That's how long it takes for something tragic to become funny.
Ugh, that's a long time to wait.
Now, the A-plot of the episode culminates with the people of the town realizing that now they can laugh at AIDS.
Hey, we're all laughing.
Oh, hey, yeah, we would have never laughed about this before.
Well, don't you see what this means? It's been 22.3 years, so AIDS is finally funny!
See, now this is where things kind of start to get subtextual. We're not really laughing at AIDS. We're laughing at the idea that you have to wait a certain amount of time to laugh at something. The only reason we can laugh at laughing at AIDS is that we know it's being played for a shock laugh. And also, in this episode, there's no victimization because the person that we thought has AIDS actually has aides who are his assistants.
My aides! Scott! Tyler! Scott is my personal trainer and Tyler is my dietitian.
Hello!
Oh, AIDES, AIDS!
Yep, hooray for AIDS!
Now, continuing to talk about the theory of comedy, not the rules of comedy, that's a different subject. The other thing you're going to see come up the most on the topic is the Mel Brooks quote, "Tragedy is when I cut my finger, comedy is when you fall into an open sewer and die." What Mel Brooks is talking about there is something that lines up with the benign violation theory, of which you can learn more of in this TED talk here. I agree with everything they say, all makes a lot of sense to me. It is, however, a bit wordy for me, so I prefer to stick to my own theories. So I thought it would be an interesting way to start this video series with something I learned from watching a season 10 episode of King of the Hill, an episode entitled A Portrait of the Artist as a Young Clown, in which we learn that no one really likes the guy who's examining comedy too closely. In this episode, Bobby gets to attend classes in clowning at the local college, and as the class clown in his school, he thinks he's going to do really well. But then he finds the professor of this class is a pompous dick.
Ah, I see. Some of you are already wearing your fright wigs. The wig isn't something you wear, it is something you earn. Do you know why the shoes wear big, or the nose be bulbous?
Funny?
Of course they're funny. They're hilarious, in fact. But if you don't know why, it is pointless. Can anyone explain this equation to me? Can you explain this?
No.
Until you can dispose of your costuming, you are nowhere near funny.
The professor of this class preaches a view of comedy that he has distilled down into a flowchart.
Comedy starts with the ha, which identifies the situation as comedic. The ha is followed by the guffaw. This creates anticipation. Next, there is the awe, to condition your audience for surprise at the final element, the ha-ha. Now does it make sense?
Not really.
I don't think the professor is wrong with his flowchart. The thing is, he's just found a very pompous way of saying what every stand-up comic already knows. Comedy builds. You start out warm, you get hot, you hook them in, and then you hit them with the punchline. Three-act structure, satire, these are all obvious things that get employed in comedy without ever needing to go to any clown college. Where he goes wrong, however, makes for the plot of the episode, as he installs in Bobby the idea that the only way to be funny is to strictly stick to the continuity of the flowchart.
It seems like just yesterday I answered to the name Dodo McGoofgoof. Oh, here's where I do the pantomime of the wrong greeting, entirely in gibberish.
Guatagalumpus, Big Scalco Mini Feaster!
All right, we have established this is funny, but why?
It's funny because it follows Aristotle's dictum, it delights. Note the gallivanting, and teaches the bear chases you since you poked him. And it follows the hog guffaw aw ha ha formula.
Congratulations, Bobby. You have just proven why I am funny. I think you're ready for character work.
Really?
Yes. We'll begin your study of commedia dell'arte, classic clowning.
When Bobby does his educated clown act in front of an audience of children, it bums.
Huh?
And now, Tartuffe, the spry wonder dog, upset the ladies' tea ceremony and is severely beaten.
Oh, God.
Of course I'd like some tea, as long as it's not going to scald me. Ow! It scalds.
Perfect. Don't be afraid of the silence.
Is Bobby's act not funny? I mean, makes me laugh, but it's definitely the wrong audience for that kind of humour. When Bobby wins the audience back is when he uses a whoopee cushion, because although that is a cheap gag, cheap gags work really well with kids. You can say you can't explain that away because kids just like that kind of thing. You could also argue that it's a base instinct comedy which connects better with young minds. But either way, you can't deny the fact that what gets a laugh with one audience is not going to get a laugh with the other.
What could possibly be funny about fart noises?
Bobby, you don't want these kinds of laughs. This laughter is ill-informed.
So through that episode, I hope you see what I'm trying to get across here. You can enjoy humor on its basic level. You can also examine it using the scientific method and using the comic method. See, there's much more to it. It's only now that I realise the comic method would have been a much better name for the series, but there you go. Addendum. It's worth noting that the funniest part of this actual episode is Dale beating John Redcorn with a ball when he's on the floor.
You bet, son.
You're out.
Great stuff.